Over the years, there have been several books and articles that were dedicated to exposing error in the Lord's church. The sheer volume of these documents indicate the importance and the scope of the problem. The theme of this lectureship is new innovations, and my topic for tonight for this lectureship is divided assemblies, or the children's church. Next hour, we're going to be talking about divided assemblies as house churches. Now, there's two aspects of house churches. We're going to talk about a different aspect of house churches than the one where you have several groups meeting in the homes with one eldership over all of those groups. That would be a divided assembly as it would be pertain to this lesson. But there's another idea, another idea of house churches that we're going to be dealing with next hour. But some of the things that we are talking about in this lesson as far as dividing the assembly for children's church, children's Bible hour, or even the house church idea where sometimes on Sunday evening or Wednesday night the congregation will break up into individual groups and meet in homes, and each one of those congregations, local little congregations, would be then under the authority of one eldership. One eldership per city with satellite congregations meeting under the oversight of that eldership. There's no authority for that. And some of the things that we're going to say in this lesson would relate to that. There have been many attacks on the assemblies of the Lord's church through the years. And this was predicted early on in the history of the church. In fact, the Bible writers warned about false teachers coming in, sneaking in privily, unawares, and leading others into damnable heresies. And especially as it pertains to worship. These innovations, of course, as we said, bring in damnable heresies. These agents of change have corrupted the worship assembly by the addition of mechanical instruments of music, changing the elements and actions in partaking of the Lord's Supper, as well as the frequency, changing the content and style of our preaching, using special music such as choirs, solos, praise teams, and such like. Altering the manner of our prayers and allowing women to take leadership role in our public worship. It seems that every item of worship has come under attack. Now, each of these innovations affect an item of worship. The aspect of worship that it affects is maybe prayer or preaching or the Lord's Supper or the contribution, whatever. And that's the items that we do in worship. Now, the controversy of divided assemblies really is attacking the very nature of our assemblies. What is the assembly in the New Testament? That's what's under consideration and under attack. They've already corrupted much of what we do in worship, but now they want to really corrupt the very nature of our assembly to worship. We think about the real issue. It's important at the outset of this study to identify which assembly is under discussion, which assembly is being corrupted. The assembly under consideration is the worship assembly of Christians on the Lord's Day. The writer of Hebrews described it as an assembly of exhortation, Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25, the latter half of that verse. Now, this does not mean that Christians are forbidden to meet in every group unless it's a full assembly of all the saints. You know, sometimes the elders, in their wisdom, may have the idea and the necessity to divide us up into specific groups for specific studies, such as maybe a young men's training class, or maybe Bible classes such as we have on Sunday morning prior to worship for different ages. You know, that's age specific. And we might have maybe a need for maybe a ladies' Bible class to teach specific things to our ladies, our young women, and women of all ages. Okay, so those aren't the types of assemblies that we're talking about. Each of these arrangements are expedient ways for the elders to make sure that the congregation gets the instruction and edification that it needs to remain faithful, and sometimes even discipline. Sometimes we may have a class that is to instruct people and teach them a specific thing so that we can discipline our lives so we can be more in keeping with God's will. The meeting, which may be divided or distinguishable from the assemblies of exhortation mentioned in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. These assemblies must not be forsaken. Hebrews 10 and verse 25 says, "Forsake not the assembly of yourselves together, as a matter of some means." By divided assemblies, we mean the removal of the children or any other group from the worship services of the Lord's church in order to meet in another part of the building for a specific service for other than the entire duration of the worship service or any part of it. Now, when we think about this, we're talking about, as previously mentioned, excluded from our present consideration are the number of special meetings that would be for a specific purpose of training young people. We're talking about when the saints come together for worship. That's the assembly that we're talking about that cannot and must not be divided. Having originated in denominations, the practice known as children's church or children's Bible hour has become increasingly popular among the Lord's church, among our brethren. The purpose of such divided assemblies is to treat children or to teach children the Bible in a way that is more conducive to their learning. It is claimed by those who promote this practice that the worship environment is not a proper place for children to learn. Now, I have, from personal experience, know that that's not true. I've seen children learn, my own children learn in the worship assembly. So that's a false assumption. We'll talk about that more later. Thus, they claim that it would be better for them to be part of a small group separate from the assembly of worship so that they might be taught on their level in a special way. The real issue before us is, do the scriptures authorize children's Bible hour, children's church, however you want to call it, during the worship assembly? That's what the issue is. Now let's look at the nature of the assembly of the saints as it's talked about in the scriptures. Now, the Christian has not been left without instruction regarding the nature of their worship to God. In every dispensation, God has told man what he wants in worship. He spelled it out, and the Christian dispensation is no exception. Revealed in the scriptures, we find specific instructions pertaining to the five authorized avenues of worship. In worship, Christians are to teach the word, we're to sing vocal as a congregation, songs, hymns, and spiritual songs while making melody in our heart. We're to partake of the Lord's Supper upon the first day of the week, remembering the body and the blood of Christ through the emblems of unleavened bread and fruit of the vine. And we're to give cheerfully according to our prosperity upon the first day of the week. And we're to sincerely pray in the name of Jesus. And this is not to be done to be seen of men. Okay? So those are the avenues of worship that we can go to the Bible and find scriptural authority to do those things. Now, it would seem odd indeed if every aspect of the acts of worship were regulated and then the very nature of assembly itself would remain unregulated. In other words, we have to do these things, but the assembly itself, we can do whatever we want. That would be odd indeed. The fact is, the nature of the assembly itself is specified just as are the various acts of worship. We haven't been left to ourselves to figure out what type of assembly God wants. He has been very specific. The Assembly of the Saints was and is the coming together of every member of the local congregation into one place as one group. I don't know how plainer I can say it. Every member in one place as one group. The purpose of the assembly is designed by the very nature to provide to provoke one another unto love and good works. At the same time, we praise and give thanks to God. That's the nature of our assemblies. That's the purpose of our assemblies. A good place to start in our discussion regarding the nature of assembly is Hebrews chapter 10. Verse 23 through 25. We've already mentioned verse 25. But notice what it says. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Here the writer of Hebrews demands that the assembly be a priority in the life of the Christian. One is not given a choice whether or not to attend. This is a command. It's not a good suggestion. In fact, we are forbidden to forsake that assembly. To forsake the assembly is to forsake the church, and if we forsake the church, then we forsake Christ. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together is not just a good suggestion, it's a command. And we sin if we forsake that assembly. That's the implication there. That phrase in chapter 10 and verse 25 is followed by verse 26, which states, if we therefore sin willfully. So those that forsake this assembly of themselves together are involved in willful sin. And they have nothing to look forward to but the fiery indignation, the wrath of God. Just read the rest of that chapter. It's talking about the judgment, the wrath of God. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God, it says. That's what awaits those that corrupt the worship, the nature of the worship, and forsake the assembly or divide it in any way. Now, the definition of the terms assembling and together is essential to our study. We need to understand what that means. We need to understand it in the English and in the Greek. We're going to look at the English first. Think about the idea of assemble. According to Webster, assembly means a company or collection of individuals in the same place, usually for the same purpose. Notice, a group of people in the same place for the same purpose. The same dictionary, Webster, defines together as in or into one gathering, group, or place. So to summarize this, the English meaning is this: every Christian in one place, at the same time, for the same purpose. The English word together is used colloquially and serves to reinforce the implication of the idea of assembling. So it's therefore reinforcing, really just state the same thing with a different word. Since the New Testament is not written in English, but in Greek, it's good to make sure that we go to the Greek language, see what the definition of these terms are in the Greek language, and make sure that our translation is accurate. So as seeing what the words in our translation mean in English, let's look at the Greek and find out what it means there. All right, assembling together is an accurate, is it an accurate translation of the Greek? The phrase assembling together comes from a Greek phrase which literally means the assembling of ourselves. Thayer says that it is a religious assembly of Christians and cites Hebrews 10 and verse 25 for an example. The root of this word, according to Thayer, means the name is translated to an assembly of Christians formerly gathered for religious purposes. Thayer cites James 2 and verse 2, which reads, "For if there come unto your assemblies and man having a gold ring as an example. So the idea of gathering together in one place implied there. From the foregoing, we learn that the English and Greek definitions agree, and both imply coming together in one place, in one group, for a specific purpose. In every instance of the use of these words in the Greek language, the meaning is always to gather together in one place with all of the inherent implications of what that means. Assembling together is therefore a correct and accurate translation of the original language. This command to assemble together refers to both morning and evening assemblies. Luke records that the disciples came together on the first day of the week to break bread, Acts 20 and verse 7. Luke does not mention the first day of every week, but yet it is implied. We understand that. They came together on the first day of every week. Even so, the command to assembly doesn't mean every worship assembly, yet it is implied. We're worshiping here. This is a worship assembly that Luke is talking about. There's nothing in the context that would limit its application only to the morning worship assembly. Okay, so we have two assemblies, one in the morning, one in the evening. The second one is a matter of expediency, I understand, but the same rule applies to both assemblies. The only difference between the morning assembly and the evening assembly is those that worship in the morning wouldn't partake of the Lord's Supper and give of their means to the contribution in the evening assembly. But still, we come together in one place for a specific purpose in one group. Now let's look at some examples of the saints assembling together for worship. As demonstrated in the foregoing, the saints are all to assemble together in one place at one time for a specific purpose. The assembly of exhortation must not be forsaken. In discussing the abuse of the Lord's Supper in Corinth, Paul says, and notice this, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 18. It said, for first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear there are divisions among you. And I partly believe it, for there must be always heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper, for in eating everyone which taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry and another is drunken. What, have you not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 18 through 22. In your daily Bible reading, I want you to go back after this lesson, and I want you to read these verses again. And notice how many times he uses the idea of coming together in one place and the unity and the fact that it's one group. It's over and over and over. We don't have time to go through there and specify every instance, but it's there. And there's no way that we can read this and not understand that this is an assembly where the whole congregation comes together in one group for a specific purpose. The word church is used in the New Testament in the following way. Sometimes it's used as the universal body of Christ, such as Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Sometimes it's talked about the realm of the saved in any geographic location, designated or not, such as 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 2, the church of Corinth, Romans 16 and verse 16, the churches of Christ salute you. Galatians 1 and verse 1, the churches of Galatia. But Paul is discussing the assembly of Christians convened for a religious purpose here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. This is a specific assembly for a religious purpose. Notice carefully that there is a coming together in the church, verse 18. Literally, this means coming together in the assembly. That's what the word church means. The King James Version renders verse 20 as when you come together, therefore, into one place, while the American Standard 1901 version reads, when therefore ye assemble yourselves together. And then verse 22 reads, or despise ye the church of God, literally the assembly of God. Thus, one single solitary assembly is under consideration in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 18 and following. The Corinthian brethren were accustomed to coming together in one place, one assembly, for the purpose of observing the Lord's Supper. Paul also states, when you come together, therefore, into one place, verse 20. The phrase in one place literally means in one and the same place in the Greek language. Consider some other places where this phrase is used. Matthew 22, verse 34. The Pharisees were gathered together. Acts 1 and verse 15. The number of the names together. There was a multitude of persons gathered together, as it is translated in the American Standard Version. Acts 2 and verse 1. They were all together with one accord. The American Standard says together in one place. Acts 2 and verse 44. Now this is talking about the early church here in these verses. And all that believed were together. Acts 4 and verse 26. The rulers were gathered together. 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 23. If therefore the whole church has come together, or assembled together, American Standard Version. So in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 23, Paul again talked about the assembly of the saints of Corinth. He said, if therefore the whole church be come together in one place. I don't think these verses could be any plainer that this is an assembly of all the members in one place for one purpose. Regarding the use of ecclesia, which is translated church, Thayer says, for as appears in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 23, the whole Corinthian church was accustomed to assemble in one and the same place. He further states that ecclesia, in the Christian sense, is an assembly of Christians gathered together for worship. An ecclesia in the religion is a religious meeting. There also cites 1 Corinthians 14, verse 19, verse 35, and 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 18 as examples of the church coming together in one place. There's no doubt that these are the same kind of assemblies as are under consideration in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23 through 25. That would be the assemblies of exhortation. So combining the total evidence and information available regarding this subject, we may conclude that the assembly in which the exhortation transpires is an assembly of a church in any geographic location, which is such as the one in Corinth, assemblies in which all members of that congregation are commanded to be in attendance, included but not limited to the first day of the week, assembly wherein the Lord's Supper is observed, and a collection taken from those in attendance, along with observance of other avenues of worship, and any assembly of the church as wherein defined and described, whose elders have called it together for the express purpose of exhortation. Acts 20 and verse 28, 1 Peter 5, verse 1 through 3, Hebrews 7, 13, verse 7 and 17. Now, we need to now we know what the assembly is, how the Bible defines it, and what the Bible says that assembly is. Now let's look at dividing it. Do we have authority to divide that assembly where all of the congregation is to come together in one place for one purpose? Can we divide that assembly? The main reason for rejecting the practice of dividing assemblies, dividing the worship assembly, is the fact that it's not authorized. There's no command. There's no example. It's not implied by the scriptures. And since there's no underlying command, we can't say that it's a matter of expediency, because an expedient has to expedite something that's authorized. Now, Since there's no scriptural authority for the practice, it's sinful. Dividing the worship assembly for things such as children's church, children's Bible hour, children's worship, is unscriptural because it violates the clear principles set forth concerning the worship assembly. We've already seen that it is a united assembly with everyone present. Paul demanded that they all come together in one place, 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 20. Paul's teaching here applies specifically to one act of worship, the Lord's Supper. And so many people take it that after the Lord's Supper's over, then we can divide. Well, no, that's not true either. However, Paul then applies this same principle in another situation that doesn't specifically mention the Lord's Supper. It's not specifically defined to the Lord's Supper. We've already mentioned that in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 23, where everyone came together in one place. That's not necessarily connected with the Lord's Supper. So this is a general principle to the worship assembly as a whole and not in part. All right. Paul applies this principle to another, the other situation that we mentioned in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 25. And in fact, in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25, then condemns the dividing of that assembly. Thus, children's church or children's Bible hour is an unscriptural division of the worship assembly. Not only is the practice not authorized in the New Testament, but it's actually condemned, as we see in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 20 and chapter 14 and verse 23. So not only is it not authorized, but it's specifically forbidden. And it's very bold when people divide that which God says to unite. We can't, we just don't have authority to do that. Dividing the worship assembly for such things as children's Bible hour is an unscriptural practice because it causes some to violate the principle of not forsaking the assembly, Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25. Many people believe that the eldership has the authority to authorize that division. Now let's think about that for just a minute. If it's a sin to forsake the assembly, and in order to have this divided assembly, there's going to be some adult Christians that are going to have to go over there with those children and teach them, right? Then this practice is causing some Christians to forsake the assemblies. Do the elders have the authority to authorize somebody to forsake the assembly? They do not. They do not. So just because the elders approve of the practice doesn't make it right. The elders can't authorize an unscriptural practice. If they do, then, you know, they were appointed, they can be disappointed, right? When an elder authorizes an unscriptural action, he ceases being qualified, they cease being qualified as elders. And they're subject to discipline. All right? So we need to be careful that we don't give elders authority beyond what the scriptures allow. That's what happens a lot of times with a lot of these innovations. The congregation says, well, the elders said we could. There's a lot of times instrumental music comes in. Well, the elders said it was okay. It don't matter what the elders say. What does the Bible say about it? These different innovations that we're going to talk about tonight and tomorrow, a lot of them are simply occurring because men are allowing it and they're not standing up and saying no. Now, just because the elders say it's okay, if we can't find authority for it in the scriptures, we have every right to stand up and say no. That's not right. We need to take those elders and show them the way more perfectly. And if things don't get straightened out, maybe time to move down the road. Find another place to worship. That's getting, by the way, friends and brethren, it's getting harder and harder to find a sound place to worship nowadays because of these innovations. I guarantee you that's the truth. And so what happens if you leave, have to leave a congregation, there's nowhere to go within driving distance. You might want to talk to Weldon and Eddie after this service, and they can tell you what happens. Start another congregation in your home, which was illegal, by the way. They had a city ordinance, a homeowners association ordinance against having an organized religion meeting in your home. They was in violation of the law, didn't know it. But then they found this place, been worshiping here ever since. This congregation is in existence because of innovations that occurred right here in Huntsville that were being allowed by the eldership of the congregation that these people came out of. When they realized that things weren't going to change, it wasn't going to get better, they had no other alternative but to seek worship elsewhere. See, that's what we're left with, brethren. We can't afford to be wrong on any of these things. We can't just sit by and let them happen and not say anything. And just say, well, the elders said it's okay. The elders can say a lot of things. That'll make it right. The practice of dividing assemblies based upon false premises. Those who participate in this practice believe that children cannot learn well in the worship assemblies. I remember my son, he was a little bit. Sue didn't even think he was paying attention. Sitting in the pew, playing with his toys, eating crackers or something. And the preacher was up in the pulpit. And he was saying, and what is the church? And Jed said, the people. Where did you get that idea? Where did you learn that? Sitting in the assembly, act like he wasn't paying attention, but he heard every word. Not bragging on my son, but just giving you an example of how that works. And we go on, and we think about this idea. It is thought that children will be better off in Bible class situations. Some of them have a separate worship. I've seen in the past where they have a whole separate worship service for the children, and they would have in that little assembly, they would have junior elders, junior deacons, junior preachers. They would serve the communion, wait on the table. They'd have their own worship service, little children. Okay? So that's some of the things that goes along with this idea that we're not really discussing. We're just talking about the practice of dividing assembly. It's thought that children would be better off in the Bible class situation, yet this is a mere assertion with no basis in fact. In reality, children can and do learn a great deal from the assembly. Godly parents can teach their children reverence for God by disciplining their children to sit quietly in worship. This is part of the father's responsibility to bring up their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4. In doing this, the children will learn how to behave themselves in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, 1 Timothy 3 and verse 15. Not only will this teach children respect in worship assembly, but it also teach them respect in any assembly, such as school. Look at our school system right now. Children, it's hard for children to learn in our public schools because of the chaos of undisciplined children. Children can and must be taught. By simple observation, children can learn much in the worship. By watching their parents and the other adults, children can learn proper attitude and respect toward prayer, the joy of singing praises to God, reverence and thanksgiving necessary in partaking of the Lord's Supper, the value of exhortation that they receive and both receive and give, the generosity in giving to the collection, according to one's prosperity. Children can learn, even learn something from the deepest, most detailed study of God's Word. By taking our children from the worship center, we're depriving them from one of the greatest educational tools that the church has to offer. The fact is, the Scriptures demonstrate that children can and do learn and belong in the assembly of the saints. We think about this, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 11 through 13. When all Israel is come together, or come to appear before the Lord, notice all of Israel. See, there's that same concept that we're talking about in our worship. When all of of Israel is come together to appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose, they shall read this law before all of Israel in their hearing. Gather the people together, men and women and children, and thy stranger that is in thy gates, that they may hear and that they may learn and fear the Lord your God and observe to do all the words of the law. And that their children, which have not known anything, may hear and learn to fear the Lord your God, as long as you live in the land whither you go to Jordan to possess it. Deuteronomy 31, verse 11 through 13. Also notice Joel 2, verse 15 through 17. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sanctify fasts. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, and those that suck the breasts, let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber, and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not this heritage to reproach, and the heathen should not rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? Joel 2, 15 through 17. Notice that there were children in these assemblies, even some that were still nursing. Also notice the reason given for their presence, that they may learn and fear the Lord your God and observe to do all the words of this law. Not only were they to be present, even a nursing child, but the purpose for them to be there was to learn. Now that's God's instruction. How dare man come along and say, well, children just can't learn in the assembly. Well, if children can't learn in the assembly, it's not their fault, it's the parents' fault. It's the congregation's fault for not making sure those children are getting the encouragement and the instruction that they need to pay attention. I remember when I first started preaching. When I preached a little congregation in Luling, Texas. And in Bible class, there was a little children's Bible class at the back auditorium. They had a glass window there with a curtain. And during Bible class, there was a little kid that would invariably take a hand puppet and put it up in front of the curtain. I'm over there trying to teach Bible class. Here's this little puppet over there doing this. What's going on in that class? That kid's doing that. Then I'm over here preaching, and I can just see this little blonde-headed kid just barely sticking his head up above the pew, running back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And then he comes back over here, and he trips, and he falls out in the middle of the aisle and rolls down the aisle. I'm over here preaching. I remember one time I was in Sedan, Kansas, and this little girl, cute little girl, had been abused by a father. Mother's over there, new Christian, and I'm preaching and worship. And that little baby gets away from her, and that little baby and I had a good relationship. She runs down the aisle, comes up there, and I pick her up, and I finish preaching over this little baby, this little kid. But you know, we need to teach our children restraint. We need to teach them discipline so that they can know how to act, so that they can learn. The Bible teaches that they can. The fact is, we must have a biblical authority for all that is done in worship and service to God. Paul commanded, whatsoever you do, word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord. Colossians 3, verse 17. Consider also the following admonitions. One is not to go beyond what is written in the Scriptures. 1 Corinthians 4, 6, one is forbidden to add to or subtract from God's Word. Revelation 22, verse 18 and 19. One is forbidden from preaching another gospel. Galatians chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. One must not bid Godspeed to a false teacher. John, 2 John 9 through 11. One must take care in the smallest of matters. Something that may seem innocent. Something that may seem to have good intentions, right? These people may have good intentions. They may be sincere. But we need to take care even in the smallest things. Nadab and Abihu learn that details are important in the way that they worship. They offered incense on strange fire. That one mistake cost them their lives. Leviticus chapter 10, verse 1 and 2. One small mistake on our part can cost us not our physical life, but our spiritual life. Those who support and practice children's church are preaching another gospel that's foreign to the scriptures. They're practicing something that's not authorized, and they're committing sin. Thank you for your time.